think that first term would be hard. Getting used to the land and learning the language. And for me, a term would probably be like 20 years at first doing those two things. But I'm glad to have these with us tonight, and I appreciate it.
Well, I'll just kind of share with you what it's like to, on the first term. The Lord knew what we could handle. And that's something that I've found out. The Lord never does put more upon you than what he's already prepared you to handle. I was thinking about faith promise today. You know, if the Lord has given you a number, he's already supplied that somehow.
Yeah.
And I think about when we first started to the mission field, matter of fact, I think the last time we were here in the church conference, we were looking at going to the field of Sri Lanka. God, for his own purposes, shut that door for us. And we looked at Liberia and West Africa, and God, for his own purposes, shut that door. And it's funny, because when I say, you always kind of have in the back of your mind, what if the Lord calls me to preach? And I thought, well, Lord, that's okay. I'll pastor in the church. I mean, you know, in the States. And then when you realize that the Lord is talking to you about mission, you say, okay, Lord, send me to a country where they speak English. And then when things like that close, you say, okay, Lord, anywhere but Spanish. I can't curl my R's, and I can't talk with the front. I talk in the back of my throat instead of it up in the front. And guess what? The Lord had other plans. But the Lord eased us into it also. We went to language school in McAllen, Texas. Now that has pluses and minuses. The plus is that yes, you can study Spanish. The minus is that yes, you still tend to fall back on English a lot. Then when we moved down to Mexico, we worked with James and Madge Brown. Again, that's a plus and a minus. The plus is they've been there for several years. They know the ins and outs. They can say to you some of the mistakes and embarrassments and other things that happened with the first-term missionary. The minus is that you still fall back on English a lot and learning the language. Then the Lord blessed us and put us with a Mexican pastor. All of a sudden, all the props are off. No crutch to lean on. It's time to learn Spanish. And we did. The Lord really blessed through that. And not only that, but working with the national, he began teaching us the culture of the people. Learning how to say, learning that eggs are huevos, and that, you know, stuff like that, the different words, that's the easy part of learning the language. But learning how they think, their culture, their mindset. I was telling someone, it's like having one TV on channel one, one on channel two, and the two don't mix too well. And you have to learn to come where they are. And I think about, you know, what Ezekiel said when he first started his ministry. He said, I don't know what they said. Amen. And I spent a large time just watching Brother Ernesto and how he talks to the people and how he witnessed to the people. And the words that he used and the man that he went about to deal with the people that he grew up with. And I've been a Christian longer than him, but I learned a lot from my younger brother. And he taught me how to witness more effectively to the Mexican people.
Amen.
And that's what it's all about. You know, you have to make a complete identification with the people that you're out to reach.
Amen.
I remember when we first went down to Mexico, many of our neighbors and stuff around said, oh, you'll get homesick in about 6 months and move back to the United States. But then when they find out that you're really trying to learn their language, trying to learn their culture, that you like their food, like to do the things that they do, all of a sudden they say, really like it here, don't you? Yes, I do. Yes, I do. And then they begin opening up, and you get to share Jesus with them. You don't get to see all of them saved, but there's open doors. Matter of fact, in all honesty, I'm to the point now, I find it easier to witness down in Mexico and door-to-door visitation and stuff than what I do here in the States. In all honesty. But again, it's that complete identification with the people. And that's what missions is all about. Going out where the people are. I like what Brother Nixon said, the highways and hedges in this room, we all have that. Amen. Whether it's in a sparsely populated Indian reservation, or whether it's in a densely populated city, we still have to go out to those highways
Amen.
And hedges and compel them
right.
to come.
Hey, Amen.
That's what mission is all about. Thank you.
Amen. 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 Tonight, I think we've got a song in Spanish. Y'all come, if you will. This is
want you to know that this is the ball bearing trio. We do the balling and you do the bearing.
Reached you.
Yes.
Right.
And they reached you. That's
And they loved your soul, and you need to be in the soul winning business.
Yes. Amen.
That's what God called you. That's why He saved you. That's the reason He left you here.
Yes. Amen.
That's the reason for it. Okay? If you found 2 Corinthians chapter 8, look in verse 9. All that was free.
Amen.
All right, look at verse 9. We will read down through verse 12. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sake He became poor, that ye through His poverty might be rich. And herein I give my advice, for this is expedient for you, who have begun before, not only to do, but also to be forward a year ago. Now therefore, perform the doing of it. That if there was a readiness to will, so there may be a performance also out of that which ye have. For if they be first a willing mind, it is accepted according to that a man has, not according to that he hath not. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you'd open hearts now, that you'd open my mind to what you have to say. And give me the ability to say it in such a way that it changed life. Not because of me, because of Jesus Christ who died for me. Pray especially now for those of you that you would again open their minds to understand what we're talking about. In Christ's name I ask you. Amen.
Amen.
You'll notice in the first part of this passage, Paul is talking about knowing what is right. You could not have come to this mission conference this week and listened to Dr. Chambers speak without knowing what's right.
Amen.
You could not have been here. You could not have sat through one of those services without knowing what's right.
Right.
But I found out a long time ago there's a big difference in knowing what's right and doing what's right.
Amen.
It's a puzzle to missionaries. You get on the mission field, you're out there working and away from people that you know, and we hear about people who did such and such a thing. And the first phrase that comes to your mind is, didn't they know better than that?
Yep.
Sure they knew better than that. They just didn't do any better.
Right.
So I want you to understand the right thing is to be on God's side.
Yes. Amen.
The right thing. God is interested in reaching the lost in this world.
Amen.
And if you can get on God's side, you're on the right side.
Amen.
It's not just knowing it, but it's doing it.
Amen.
It's doing it. If I could title this sermon anything, I'd title it Performing the Doing of It. So that's the most important thing. Performing
Amen.
The doing of it. First of all, make a purpose in your heart. This I'm going to do. What happens in this world is not going to stop me from doing what God has laid on my heart.
Amen.
I'm going to do it.
Amen.
Being able to teach faith promise in both Colombia and Ecuador, some strange things happened. When I introduced it to the church there in Medellin, the lady who was treasurer of the church said it won't work. Said it's scriptural, it'll work. She said, it won't work. Said, you're going to find out that people quit giving their tithes and their other offering to give to this mission offering. That's what she said the first night. By Sunday, she had two young boys, and by Sunday, one of the young boys said, I'm going to give a faith promise offering. And she said, son, you better recognize right now, I am not going to give it to you. And he said, I'm not going to ask you. That young man kept his commitment to Christ all year long. He's right on his faith promise offering. Promised 200, given 800.
Amen.
And maybe the next one would come in. Promised 200, given 500. And he loaded on there so I'd know who it was. He wanted to know that God was providing it and God was doing it.
Amen.
And he did it all year long. He did it all year long. Mother became angrier and angrier as the year went by. I told you it's different than knowing what's right and doing what's right.
Amen.
Because if you do what's right, you're going to surrender your will to God's will.
Right.
And you're going to say, God, your will is more important in my life than my will. And I'm going to learn submission. I'm going to submit to your teachings and your doctrine. And I'm not going to fight this thing. I'm going to be part of it.
Amen.
We got into Ecuador. We talked. talked to Brother Ben Mock and said, we're using faith promise in Columbia. He said, does it work? I said, sure. He said, it works. He said, would you teach it to the church here? So I got to teach it to that church. And then as the missionaries came by, we got to meet the missionaries. And missionaries got it. Do you know that?
Amen.
They took that story all over Ecuador, what we were doing there.
Amen.
And they told everybody, you're going to see that church up there in Cayambe. They got faith promise in that church. And they're reaching out with mission. And all those people are enthusiastic about mission. And I talked to some of the people here in this church. Strange thing. All those missionaries, most of those missionaries are old and bald-headed and gray. And I talked to a young girl. She said, you know, this is the most exciting week in our church.
Amen.
And I look forward to this every year.
Amen.
This is the most exciting time in this church.
Amen.
I taught at the church there. It's with all over Ecuador. And they asked me, even after I left, if I come back, teach them how to do it. We made a special trip back. I remember teaching it in the church, and I remember the goal that we set, and I remember spending hours praying, Lord, what if we don't make that goal? Nobody else in the church was worried about it, but I was. Lord, what if we don't make that goal? We went over it. We went over it.
Praise God.
And I remember counting those faith promise offerings, tallying them up, see how much we went out for missions that year. And I remember a little girl who sat on the second row back at church. She was about 3 years old. And I remember her coming to church every Sunday. And she had a coin in her hand, and she'd flip that coin up and catch it. Sometimes she didn't catch it. The floor was wood tile, beautiful tile. She'd flip that coin up in the air, and it would fall and hit that floor. And it would roll here and roll there, and she'd get up and go get it. And I thought, Lord, would you please let that mother control that little girl? Would you please get her under control, Lord? It's bothering me immensely. I'm sitting up here on the platform getting ready to preach, and all I can see is that coin going up in the air. And I know she's not going to catch it this time, and maybe it's going to hit somebody. Would you please get that mother, let that mother get that little girl under control? About 6 months into the Faith Promise program, mother brought that. Went to the house to talk to my wife one day, and she said, you know Graciela made a faith promise this year? That was a three-year-old girl. She said, you know, in this 6 months, Graciela has never missed a Sunday?
Amen.
She said, you know, my husband and I are behind, but Graciela isn't. When my wife told me, I remembered the coin. And I remember what she did with it then. She always put it into a faith promise envelope.
Amen.
And put it in the offering.
Praise God. Amen.
Now, Graciela didn't have a job. She didn't have any money. She didn't have any income. And I asked her dad, how is she doing it? And he said, well, she gets birthday money and she puts it in there.
Amen.
Said, do you know she never spends any money on candy or ice cream or Coca-Cola until she's got her faith promise?
Amen.
She, that's first in her life. Oh, that's called performing the doing of it.
That's right.
That's called right. Performing the doing of it. Said, sometimes when Graciela doesn't have any money, she will ask us, can we go visit Granddaddy today? Crawl on Granddaddy's lap and say, Granddaddy, I don't have my faith promise yet.
Amen.
You give it to her.
Amen.
Now I'm talking about a reprobate Christian that's already under church discipline. He's so bad the church pastor said, don't come back to this church for a year. You can't even come back to repent. I don't want to see you in this church for a year. Granddaughter crossed for his left and broke his heart. And he got a right back to the Lord.
Amen.
And he came to me and said, thank you for teaching that.
Amen.
Thank you for teaching that in church.
Amen.
Well, Graciela, a missionary now. She's 6 years old. Her mother and dad are missionaries. So is she.
Amen.
You talk about these missionaries, you're going to find out the most effective missionary in the family. Children.
That's right.
Most effective is the family. farming than doing it. Getting out and letting it be known what needs to be done. Talking to lost souls about their soul's condition.
Amen.
Loving those souls into the kingdom of God, in the family of God.
Amen.
That's mission.
Right.
See, Graciela was not even saved yet. She is saved, but she's not saved. You see, Graciela was just 3 years old when she started this, and she had not yet understood what sin was. So God sent his son. His son died on Calvary, and John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin," not the sins, but the sin of the world.
Right, yeah.
And so Jesus Christ died for those sins. He died for the sin of the world. The idea of being born into sin, as well as the sins of the world. So Graciela didn't have to worry about her salvation until she understood the difference between right and wrong. Chose wrong. Oh, incidentally, you became responsible for your sins at the same age.
Right.
When you understood the difference between right and wrong, and you chose to do wrong, you became responsible for your
sins. Right.
And then Jesus said, "If any man come unto me, I will in no wise cast him out."
Right.
So he gave a promise to those of you who would come to Christ and say, "Lord, I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. I want to take you as my personal Savior.
Amen.
I want to be saved."
Amen.
So incidentally, that's called performing the doing of it.
Right.
That's called performing the doing of it. When you preach that word, when you preach that message, whether it's here, or in Brazil, or in Colombia, or in South Korea, or in New Zealand, or in Mexico, or in Venezuela, or in Canada, or in Cuba, wherever you preach that word, God's promise it'll not return void. It'll not return void.
Right.
Take a 5-hour trip out of town, down a mountain road, and then you get on a boat and you ride for 4 hours on a boat to a place to preach the word of God. You think you've done a great thing, come a long way. 7-year-old boy, 4 hours through the mud, borrowed a canoe and crossed the river, and he comes to church.
Amen.
Night, by himself.
Amen.
Hear the word of God. Performing the doing of it. He's your accordion, he said. How much does one of those accordions cost? You look at him and you say, "Son, how do you tell a 7-year-old boy how much an accordion costs? Beyond his ability to buy it." You say, "Son, it costs about as much as a yearling costs." You raised on a farm, you know what they're worth. You say, "That much? But I'd like to have one for church, but..." Come back to the States, you talk to a bunch of young people in junior church. They start taking up an offer for Pedro. Have an accordion.
Amen.
Take up so much money to buy him one and me one too.
Amen.
Pedro's got an accordion.
Amen.
Performing the doing of it. Pedro was about that tall when he got his accordion. He walked around like this. "When I get grown, I want you to be just like Pastor Joaquin." I hope so.
Amen.
Lord, help me walk to heal me, that I'll be an example to him.
Amen.
Pedro's no different from the children that are here.
Right.
You go to that place, after you've gone the 4 hours in the boat, spend the next 3 hours visiting and telling people church service is going to be that night. Then you go back to the little chapel building that's thatch-proof, dirt floor, split bamboo walls, start the Coleman lantern, get that thing going, get the accordion out, get the dust off of it, start playing, and people start coming. They're bringing their chairs with them. They fill the building. You've done this before. You're already tired. You started 5 o'clock that morning, and the day is not over yet. Someone hands you a note, you don't even have time to read it. You preach a message, and you, someone just comes to our house and have some coffee. You go back, bring your hammock up, put your mosquito net over that, put your shoes under the bed, and get into your hammock to go to sleep, but you can't go to sleep. And you remember the note. Reach in your pocket, pull the note out, begin to read it. It's been written by someone with a hard lead pencil, and you know what it is like. He's wet the pencil about every 3 words, and that first letter is real dark, and it gets lighter. Hard to read. Finally, you get it deciphered. It says, "We're a small group of Christians meeting in a place called Los Cargueros. Could you come up and help us?" The next morning, when church service began, someone said, "Did you read the note?" And I said, "Yes, I read it, but I can't do anything about it." And the lady said, "Why can't you?" I said, "Don't have any money. I don't even know where it is. I don't know how to get there." Someone in the back of the church says, "I know where it is, and I can take you. Don't have any money. Can't go." Another lady stands up and she says, "Preacher, when you're not here even, we take up offerings. Couldn't we use that money to pay your way up there? My brother lives up there, and he needs to know the Lord."
Amen.
So the next day we bought gasoline, put in the outboard motor, got in the boat, and went up to Los Cargueros. And that's where I met Mark. About the third trip up. He had been waiting for me for a week to get there to be baptized. About 5 hours into the mountains, waited a week for me to get there to be baptized. Oh, that's called performing the duty.
Yes. Amen.
That's called performing the duty. Los Cargueros has a large church now on its own. The man who wrote me the letter was killed in a landslide. Marcus was killed. Snake bit him, but there was no help for him. He walked 5 hours down to the church and he said, "This is where my brothers live, and this is where I was baptized. This is where my church membership is. If I got to die, I'm going to die here."
Amen.
This cost me. Do you realize this morning in the heat of the moment, I got all emotionally involved, and I said I was going to give such and such a month. You realize I got to work 2 hours a week just to give it away? Yes, praise the Lord.
Amen.
You will not lose anything by this.
That's right.
I got a promise in Ecuador, and I got a promise in Colombia. If you lose money on this faith promise offering, would you tell me next year and I'll replace it?
Amen.
I think I can make it safely here, too.
Amen.
If you lose something this year, you keep an account of it. You let me know next year. I'll replace it.
Amen.
I don't want you to lose anything by serving the Lord. You never will. You
right.
Never will.
Amen.
You never will lose anything by serving the Lord.
That's true.
God will replace it.
Yes.
He'll replace it.
Amen.
Got down in the Columbia, and I got a church paper. I read about it some years back. Said there was a new Bible Institute going up, a new school to teach preachers, and it was going to be called the Isles Anderson School. I looked at it and I read it, and I know who Jack Isles is, but who's Anderson? And I was dumb, so I asked a new missionary, "Who's Anderson in this Isles Anderson College?" He said, "Anderson's a missionary." Ah, that's the reason Jack Howell got with him. Anderson's a millionaire. He's trying to give $1 million away, so he won't be a millionaire anymore. So far, he's failed in doing it. gave it away by the shovel full, and God gives it back to me by the shovel full, but God's got a bigger shovel than I do.
Amen. Amen.
Before I got up to preach tonight, I got to thinking about what we give. You see, when I began this ministry, I thought it was a give and take that you gave and I took. And I thought it's scriptural for you to give, because I was a missionary and I was going to the foreign field. And really, I didn't know where I ought to be involved in the giving or not. I'm a member of a local church and I ought to be involved in the giving.
Amen.
Amen. Give it to my local church.
Amen.
Joe and I will give about over 20% of our income this year. Now you're looking at some rich people. There's one right there, there's one right there, there's one back there, there's one right there, and here's another one right here. We're very wealthy. There's another one right there. We're very rich. I've been in the mission over 28 years now. And my take home, I'm a wealthy missionary. My take home is, I'm up there now. I'm making about $1,000 a month. We're giving 20% of it away besides the tithes and offerings. We're giving over 30% of it away.
Amen.
We're feeding 9 people in my house. And you can see I ain't missed very many people.
Amen.
I'm wearing a new suit. Looks like Brother Chambers. We got it from the same store. But I'll tell you something, Brother Chambers paid more for his than I did mine. You see, the Lord takes care of me, and he put a plant over here, he put a store over here in Columbus called J.P. Penney. Outlet store. And you know, some dumb manager knew that Jack Weaver needed slacks, and so he put her back room back there in the back, and every time I go in there, they got my size. And they sell them to me for $11 a pair.
Amen.
And I buy them. But I'm dumb, I really don't know what I'm doing. So I walk out to the other J.C. Penney store and say, you got a coat that matches these slacks? And they said, why sure, it's on sale too. You get it reduced price.
Yeah.
Well, I can wear a new suit a lot cheaper than the Chambers can. He's not here to dispute this.
Amen.
You think God takes care of his own?
Amen.
Do you think God only takes care of the missionaries? Do you think God doesn't know what you need before you need it?
Amen.
Do you understand what I'm talking about?
Yes, sir.
Please propose in your heart this year, I will not be late. Before I promise God. This year I'm going to perform the doing of it. Got about halfway through the year there in Kayami, and we left the thermometer up to measure what we were giving each month of mission. What we promised and what we were giving. We were a little bit behind. I got to praying about it. Lord, help us get caught up. I don't want to be behind. We want to be behind in what we promised the Lord. So I told the church, in 2 Sundays, we're going to have a double up Sunday. And if you promise the Lord $10, we're going to double it up, and this week we're going to give $20, because I don't want to be behind what we promised God. We're going to perform the doing of it. 11th month in that faith promise program, we busted the top out of that.
Amen.
We gave more than we promised to give.
Amen.
We performed the doing of it.
Right.
I hope by this time next year, your pastor will say, you know, we had some new people come in.
Hey. Amen.
And they want to get involved in this faith promise program too. And you know, we got some old people here in this church that practice double up Sunday.
Amen.
We've gone over our promise.
Amen.
We're performing the doing of it.
Yes. Amen.
We're performing the doing of it.
Praise
God. You're here tonight. Never taken Christ as your personal Savior. I wouldn't need you know. I don't know who you are, but God knows and you know. If you've never taken Christ as your personal Savior, you don't have a better opportunity than right now.
Right. Amen.
You will never have a better opportunity. You will never meet with a bunch of people as loving as these are here today.
Right. Or if that.
You don't have anything to fear or worry about. I'm not talking about something that's going to cost you a lot of money. I'm talking about something that's free.
Amen.
I'm talking about something that was paid for 2,000 years ago and held in your name just waiting for you to claim it.
Yeah,
amen.
Right.
All you have to do is say, I want it.
Yes.
That's all you have to do. You know, the marvelous thing about this country, there are several million dollars held in bank accounts across this country waiting for someone to come in and claim it. It really belongs to you. But the most marvelous thing about this country is there is a special reward waiting for you. Called salvation.
Yes. Amen.
Worth more than all the banks in this country.
Yes. Amen.
Because it's the price of people.
Yes.
And it's yours free. All you have to say is, I want it.
Amen.
That's all you have to say is, I want it.
Right.
You know, you can't depend on anyone else to take it for you. You have to take it personally.
Yes. Amen.
You need a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you can have it tonight. You can have it tonight. Just by faith. This thing I want to do. I want to be Christ as a personal thing.
Amen.
No one has to tell you you're a sinner. You know that already. You know that already. You know yourself better than anyone else in this world. And you know you failed God who gives you.
Amen.
You failed everyone else. And your only hope is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You're not happy with the life you led, and you know it. You need to perform the duty better tonight.
Yes.
You need to perform the duty better tonight. Would you stand with me? Every head bowed, every eye closed. I don't want anyone looking around. I want to know how to pray. I don't really know how now. If you're here tonight, you've never taken Christ as your personal Savior. Would you do me a favor and raise your hand? No one's going to know about this but me and you. And I don't know how to pray for you. Would you do me that favor? If you're here tonight, you've never made a decision for Christ. No one's going to say anything to you. It's between you and me and God. No one's looking around. You've never made a decision to take Christ as your personal Savior. Would you raise your hand and say, preacher, pray for me? Would you do that right now? Would you do that while I wait? I'm not going to say anything to you. Only you and God know. But if you're here tonight and you've never taken Christ as your personal Savior, you need to do that right now. Man, woman, boy, or girl. Let me ask you another question. If you're here tonight and you've never been scripturally baptized, but you know you should be, would you raise your hand and say, preacher, pray for me, and I need to make that decision? I see one hand. Is there another? Is there another? You can put your hands down a little bit and pray now. Father, I thank you for this person who was honest with me and said, pray for me. I need to be baptized. Father, I feel that there's people here tonight who need to be saved. Oh, Lord, see what that's in me this morning without making a decision for you. But we don't know how much time they have left. But we do know they have now. Lord, would you please move their hearts to raise their Lord your life? I will be saved. Father, I pray especially for this person that led me to be baptized. That make that decision present themselves to the church tonight. Father, for the rest of us, we just need to be involved in the form you're doing that. Would you help us understand? We're not responsible for other people, just for us. We need to be involved in doing it. I ask for all this in the name of Jesus, who died for you on Calvary. Amen. While the piano player is playing this song of invitation, God spoke into your heart. Would you let it be known by passing here at the front saying, Lord spoke to my heart tonight. I will get things right. Maybe your life is not what it should be. Maybe there's something in your life that's keeping you from serving the Lord. But as she plays, you want to make that right. This is the time to do it. God's spoken to your heart about your salvation. This is the time to do something about it too. Would you let him have his way in your life? Spoken about that, this is the time to make it number two.
He just took care of that, healed it. So
we're just praising God. And I saw him deaf when I couldn't talk and I couldn't get the words out. I couldn't relate to people for a few days there and had trouble with that. I just told God, I said, if you'll let me preach again, if you'll let me just get out there and tell people, I just want to do more than I ever have for you. We just appreciate it. This song I'd like to, we especially like to do because we dedicate this to the prisoners and all of us wearing the same fix at one time. I was dancing in prison, all so dark and cold. Just a lost sheep wandering from God's eternal fold. Then the door swung open, Jesus said to me, I have signed your pardon, now you may go free. Amen. Since the Savior led me from that awful place, I can hear the angels sing, they sing the amazing grace. I know I was pardoned from my sin and shame. Now I join in singing glory to his name.
Amen.
Jesus signed my pardon, this I surely know. Took my place on Calvary so I don't have to go. All my life I give him, he gave it for me. When he signed my pardon there on Calvary, life is now worth living since he set me free. I know he was willing to save a wretch like me. Now I own a mansion, not a prison wall.
Amen.
For he signed my pardon, yes, he paid it all.
Amen.
On my way to heaven, happy every day, since the blood of Jesus washed my sins away. Glory, hallelujah, there at Calvary, Jesus signed my pardon, yes, he set me free. Someday soon he's coming, praise his holy name. I shall live forever, free from sin and shame. I shall rise to meet him at the trumpet call. For he signed my pardon, yes, he paid it all. Jesus signed my pardon, this I surely know. Took my place on Calvary so I don't have to go. All my life I give him, he gave it for me. When he signed my pardon there on Calvary.
Amen.
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 Well, that's good. Thank you, Lewis and Knox. It's been a pleasure having them this week. First time they've been with us here. The Lord willing, will be the last. We may just call them, have them come down to Central Court.
Amen.
By the way, I'm going to buy me one of those things. I found the key, and I always let the key to people sing. And I know what is that little thing he carries around the car. If I get one of those, I can sing now. Now, ushers, our missionaries, you're helping us out. I want you to come back. You fill out one of these papers. If you will, look at it real fast. Again, it says my faith promise offering for worldwide, for world evangelism through Bible Baptist Church. Excuse me. In dependence upon God, I will endeavor to give each week toward the worldwide ministry of my local church the amount checked in the column at the right. Now, as the Lord has led you to, I would like you to fill out. Again, let me say, there is no place for a name. That means that no one knows but God and you. You will never receive a bill. It's not a bill. This is an agreement between you and God. And my friend, if you'll have a part, do so. You'll be glad you did. What you sow, you reap. I'll tell you what, my friend. We need to get busy sowing. We need to get busy. If you'll have a part tonight, join with the Father. Thank you for this time, this purpose, this place, Lord. Most of all for the harvest give that the gospel might go, we are continuing the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. God help us each one to have that heart tonight. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you have filled these out, or if you will fill them out, just fold them, then hand them over to the missionary. Brother Nixon, if you will, let them get home with you. Your wife will come and give us a testimony just real fast, if you will, right up a minute here. Or just where you are right now. We'll see you in a minute. If you will, stand and give us a word of testimony, Brother Nixon, Mrs. Nixon, right now.
Not as young as he used to be.
Yeah.
by faith as we've stepped out together. And my friend, I believe what God has laid on our hearts, I believe God will do. I really do. And I thank God this evening, this morning, this evening, that the Lord has put in your hearts and our hearts as we've joined together the promise this year, $38,439.96. he takes on a lot of things, and this can go back and forth and help.
Yes.
Just save him many, many hours of time. Brother Cummins.
Now, if my kids were here, it would already been unwrapped.
I didn't give anybody a chance to hear a while ago. referring to any of you have. Anything you want to say right now is the time.
I just want to tell you that we need to do a pretty good. My wife has needed some help some time already. I just can't tell you thank you enough.
Amen.
Amen.
I want to thank you. You know, it's a blessing. You know, missionaries, they're on the front line of the warfare with Satan. It's good to come back to the rear every now and then, amen? And regroup and replenish. And it's always been a replenishing for me at Bible Baptist Church here in Lancaster. It's a good refreshing time for me. But you know, it's good when you're on that battlefield, on that front line, every now and then, to see that helicopter come in and jump off of the fly.
Yeah.
Thank y'all for being part of that delivery to us, amen?
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Anyone else?
I want to thank that man, that lady. He did all that special work for us this week.
Yeah. Amen.
You close your ears. You have a very special pastor in his life.
Yeah. That's right. Amen.
You have a very special pastor. We sit in your home this week.
Amen.
And he's very
going. Thank you all. I appreciate the
lucky.
I just want to say that wherever you have to get involved in the cooking, you get to know the missionaries and what they do, and it just feels like more family. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
shall we stand?